You're listening to Bad Dog Agility, bringing you training tips, interviews, and news about the great sport of dog agility.
I'm Jennifer Crank, and this is episode 207. Today's podcast is brought to you by HitItBoard.com. HitItBoard.com has the innovative training tools you need for agility. Having trouble with your dog walk or A-frame? The HitItBoard can fix that. Your dog doesn't like tugging? They'll love the Tug-It. Can't move your A-frame around by yourself? The Move-It can. Go to hititboard.com and use discount code BDA10 to get 10% off your order. That's hititboard.com. Today's podcast is also brought to you by Elite Science. Unlock your dog's full potential with a unique competitive edge solution, 1TDC. 1-tetradecanol complex is a patent blend of unique fatty acid oils designed to safely and effectively keep joints and muscles at their best to maximize performance and shorten recovery time. 1-TDC is the next generation of fatty acids beyond glucosamine and fish oil and is used by many current and past national agility champions and world team members. All of our listeners will automatically qualify for a great 1-TDC special offer by purchasing online at BDA1TDC.com. That's BDA, the number 1-TDC.com. I'm so very excited to welcome one of my agility idols and the 2018 Medium Dog Agility World Champion gold medalist, Martina Magnoli-Klimsova. Am I saying that correct, Martina?
Almost, yes. Thank you.
And so this year, you just are coming home with the win of this gold medal with your Moody Kiki. Welcome to the podcast and congratulations on having an amazing agility weekend a few weekends ago.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased. I can talk to you now.
Yes, it was amazing being on the podium right next to you with Swift and I taking the silver. I've had medium dogs all my life and attended my first FCI event in 2004. So for me, you and Kiki are a legacy in the sport. It's a true honor to take silver next to you and now to be able to do this interview.
Oh, thank you so much. And congratulations. I watched your runs later on the video and it was really great.
Thank you so much. Thank you. So am I correct that during your interview after you won the gold medal that you announced to the crowd that Kiki is 10 and a half years old?
Yes, she's 10 and a half years old.
Wow, that's incredible. So at 10 and a half years old, Kiki has accomplished a lot in her career. You won the European Open in 2015, and that was after placing in the top four for the three previous years. You kind of had a countdown of fourth place, third place, second place, and then you won in 2015. You had team gold in 2012 and 2015 at the AWC. And then, am I correct, this is your third individual gold. So you had gold in 2014, 16, and this year in 2018. Is that correct?
Yes, it's correct.
And let's not all forget, everyone, you also were a member of the silver medal team. So you were up on the podium twice this year, gold and individual, silver and team. Is there any certain accomplishment that you have that has more meaning to you than any of the others?
I think it's hard to say because every result has some story behind. I think that I will always remember European Open 2015, the final, because Kiki doesn't like the sand. She's quite small for the category, so I think it's too heavy. And she was struggling in other rounds. But in the final, I think she felt it's so important for me. And I think she gave 1,000%. She was really fighting as much as she could. So took my heart. And then in 2016, when she won the individual medal in Spain, I think it was very special because that year, I think she was the fastest medium dog. So she was the fastest one and even with the two clean runs. So I was very proud. And of course, this year, the individual agility final, because again, it reminded me a little bit the European Open 2015. I felt that she's just running over her limit. So really thankful and it's a great feeling.
Yeah, if I have my stats correct, you finished in sixth place in jumpers this year and then went on to smoke that standard course and really jump a lot of placements. So you really felt like she put on the afterburners and really stepped up to the plate in that agility round?
I think she really knows it, you know, and then she gave her 1,000%. She was saving all the energy to give it in the last round.
That's awesome. So tell us a little bit more about Kiki for maybe those people that don't know your history. I mean, I'm a big follower, and I believe she's your first and only Moody. Is that correct?
Yes, she's the first and only.
So what are your greatest strengths on course? And over the last 10 and a half years, what have you really struggled with both during training or trialing?
So I think that at the beginning, I don't train agility with the puppy. And I was focused a lot to help her with her problem because she was the most shy puppy I ever have met in my life. And first we had to go through that. And because she fell in love with me immediately, I think after 3 hours, she decided that I'm a god. So thanks to the strong relationship, we were able to go over that. And then in agility, we were a little bit struggling with the jumping technique because she's from the nature, she's not really talented with the jumping. And she had a tendency to make a lot of short strides. But with that, we would lose a lot of time. So I had to rebuild her jumping style. And now she's able to do really long, long strides. And in what she's special on the course is that she's not doing one more step. So she's always in the perfect line. And with that, she's able to beat even... the dogs, they can be much faster on the straight line. So she's very tight. And
yeah, she's very efficient. She's very tight on her line, where other dogs might be faster, but they're taking those wider turns. You can gain on them and beat them there, right?
Yes.
So you mentioned you didn't do a lot of agility training when she was a puppy. You just worked on, you know, building confidence and establishing a relationship. So when do you normally start your dogs on their agility training? Do you have kind of a set program, or do you just, you know, measure each dog and read each dog individually?
Of course, it's special for every dog because every dog is a little bit special. My first goal is to have a good relationship and to have dog easy in a common life, because that's the most important. That's because most of the hours together we spend in a common life. And then I have a lot of games. They are connected with agility, but not really like sequences or training on agility equipment. So I train jumping grids, and now I have special games. I call it special games. And in those games, I can shape the behaviors. So I shape the jumping skills. And of course, I have a puppy program. So I want my dog to be always ready to play with me and to have fun to play with me and tug with me and retrieve the toys. And of course, the basic obedience. And I shape them a lot of tricks. And we already, from the beginning, we follow my fitness program. So I want to develop as much as possible the coordination, the proper reception. So there is so much job that with a real agility, I can call it in that way, we start when the dog is 12 months. And with the large dogs now, I have a border collie puppy. She's 9 months. And I want to start with a real agility maybe when she will be 14 months.
That's
with
awesome.
With one jump and two jumps exercises. And so the sequences I will do when she will be 16, 17 months, not earlier.
That's awesome to hear, because I think there's a lot of discussion here in the United States about, you know, what is the appropriate time to begin training the dogs or to begin trialing the dogs. So it's really great to hear your perspective about really establishing that solid foundation of just a relationship in the other games before really, you know, trying to get a 5 or 6 month old dog started, you know, on sequences right away. So I love your perspective on that, and also the value that you put on keeping them fit and keeping them in shape.
Oh, thank you. I graduated on veterinary university, so it's my topic, let's say, to keep the dog in condition, because it's connected to what I studied. And I think the biggest danger for the puppies is when they turn tight in the speed. That's the problem. And that is why I try to avoid this. And I think it's always better to wait half a year, 8 months longer, if then it means that you can compete maybe 4 years longer. So I think it pays back.
So I'll jump to a question I had saved for later, but I think now it sounds like would be a good time to ask. We've had some people submit questions, and a lot of people ask the question of, how do you keep Kiki in such great shape to be so competitive at 10 and a half years? I think people were really shocked when they found out her age after coming home from that gold medal win. So what's your secret? Is it the fitness? Is it your training? Are you doing something special with diets and supplements?
So that's very complicated to answer because I can talk about hours and hours. I think the basic points are not to start too early, so to wait that the body is ready, to work a lot on proprioception, coordination with the dogs, because that you can prevent that they will be injured. And of course, it's about nutrition. It's about the management of the training. So maybe you will be surprised, but I almost don't train the whole courses or long sequences. So I'm focused on precision. So I'm working on 1, 2, 3 jumps. And of course, on my special games, I already talked about why shape the behaviors. And I work on grit exercises. And then I think what is very important is that the dog is really happy in the life. Because I trust that the happy dog means the healthy dog. And then, of course, I have some warm-up routine, which is very important as well. And so it's so much, so many information. But if somebody will be interested, I am opening again in December the Fit Fun class for the dogs. And there I will share all my experiences and knowledges. We opened this class with Deborah Severo. She's an amazing Italian physiotherapist, and she works with humans but also with dogs. So if somebody's interested, that's the option.
I'm so happy to hear that, because that's so much in line with, you know, how I feel about things. And I'm constantly telling students, take your time, you know, no reason to rush. And I feel like there's this trend of wanting to start dogs, in my mind, what would almost be too soon in many cases. So there you have it, guys, straight from Martina, the gold medal's mouth, the magic secret to keep your dog running at 10 and a half years old. So how is your training and trialing different now with Kiki being older and more seasoned than it was when she was younger? Do you do a little less training because you feel like she has that experience? Are you doing just as much? What's the difference between now and say maybe when she was 3 years old?
So the only difference is that our regular winter breaks or the agility breaks are getting longer and longer. So the first 2 years, I gave her 6 weeks of agility, and then I gave her 8 weeks, and then I gave her longer and longer and longer break. And since she was 6 years, I gave one more break, a little bit shorter after European Open. Otherwise, the trainings are always the same, because I don't think I train too much, so I can train with older dogs in the same way. What is important, I never train too long, and I don't train only agility. So I follow my fitness program, and of course, we are going outside for walks, and every day we do some tricks outside. And every training has a topic, so I always have a plan what I'm going to do and why, and I have the plan for one training, and I have the plan for a week, and I have the plan for 1 month, and I have the plan for a year. And because I have a lot of ideas what to teach her, till now, I was always teaching her new and new skills. So I continue to keep the skills she had already or she knew already. And to that, I always add something new, because I just love to train with her and I love to train the dogs. And so it's a lot of small exercises and maybe 80%. And just 20%, we work on the longer sequences or we run the whole courses. And I consider those agility breaks very, very important, because they give to the body the chance to recover. So it doesn't mean that we would not do anything for 6 weeks. We just don't do anything connected with agility.
Excellent. That's definitely good to hear and kind of get a perspective on what maybe contributes to that consistent success you've had year after year after year. You know, this is not your first medal. It's not your first time out there. You have dominated the sport. You've dominated that medium division year after year after year. What do you think is that, you know, what do you think contributes to your constant success? It's not just that one awesome run that won you in the finals. I mean, you have been consistent over and over. What would you say is the main contributor to that?
I think that very important is that if I'm going to the competition, if I'm on the start line, I'm going to run a clean run. And I have no doubt about that. I'm going to run a clean run. And that confidence is coming from the training. I already said that I train a lot of small exercises. And on those, I allow the dog to make mistakes and to find the right way, and that's fine. But I try to manage the training so that if I'm going to run a longer sequence or the course, the whole course, from the beginning, I try to do it in the way I'm going to do a clean run. It means I start with the sequences, the longer sequences, and with the courses later when the dog is maybe 19 months, when the dog is ready for that. And I'm going to run only those sequences and courses. I know there is a high chance we are going to do a clean run. So then my habit is, if I see the course or longer sequence, my habit is to make a clean run. And then, of course, it's easier to do a clean run. And so that's the first aspect. And the second is that my handling system helps a lot, because I think the dogs are much more handy than we are. So I like to put a lot of responsibility on them. It means I teach them a lot of skills. So then to handle them, it's easier for me. My handling system may look for somebody too difficult, because I use a lot of verbal cues. And it, because of that, it may look for somebody a little bit complicated. But for me, it's just another language. Because I start with the small exercises, even with humans, with the handlers. My students, they learn this language step by step. And then what is important, if you learn it step by step, and it's quite easy for you, and you make it then automatically. So if I am handling Kiki, I don't have to think about now I have to show her with my left arm and I need to do one step with my left leg and I have to say this cue or that cue. My body is doing that alone. It's automatically, like when I talk the Czech. And these automatically moves are not so much influenced with the stress. So then it's easier to have a clean run.
I loved hearing your, you know, discussion and talking about the mental game. You know, stepping to the start line and saying, yes, I'm going to run clean. Cause I think that's something, you know, we don't see a lot of top handlers talking a lot about the mental game. So I love your perspective on that. Let's talk about this year's Agility World Championship. Did you prepare yourself or Kiki differently this year than you have in years past?
No, it was even a little bit challenge for me, because after European Open, we moved from Czech Republic to Italy. Because my husband is Italian, so we had the opportunity to move to live in Italy, in the beautiful mountains. But of course, there is not much time between European Open and World Championship, so it was a little bit crazy. But I was able to follow my plan, and I prepared well for World Championship. But I didn't do anything special, but I never do anything special. So it was fine.
Now, you also took the team silver medal. So you and your teammates took the silver in the medium division. Were your teammates people you had teamed with before? And do you guys get together and train together? Or do you all train separately and then you just meet up at the event to work together on team?
So, of course, we meet on qualifications in the Czech Republic. And the team who is qualified for World Championship is running together on European Open and the Czech Championship. And I think I can say that our team, the Czech medium team, is really one of the strongest, because from 2012, we were able to win 2 gold and 2 silver. I think that's really cool. And I think we are so strong because we are able to be the real team, and we always discuss the strategy, and we make the coursework together. And because we know each other, we can give some advices, or we can support in the best way, because we know what the others need. And I think the most important is that we have really one goal. We want to win. We want to do our best for the team. That's important. We really want to do it for the team.
So did you say that the team, the four of you that teamed together a couple weeks ago at the World Championships, it was the same four of you that teamed together at the European Open this year?
Yes.
That's cool. I find that very cool. In the States, we have separate tryouts events. So in the States, our European Open tryouts is different than our AWC tryout. So you have different teams. So the people that you might be on a team with in July at the EO are different than the people that you might be on a team with at the Agility World Championship. So that's pretty cool that you guys get to team together for a longer period of time. It really gives you the chance to know each other, as you said.
Yes, and then it's easier to decide who will run the first and who will run the last and who will run the second. And so it's good. I really like that Eliska, our teammate, she's always running the first, because if she does a clean run, and she always does a clean run, then I just feel we are going to do it. We will do it, and we always do it. So it's good that we have some experience before the World Championship together. That's absolutely true.
Wow, that's so cool to hear. So you can't watch your runs with Kiki without being amazed and impressed with your beautiful running contacts. What went into your decision to teach running contacts, and then how did you train these?
Yeah, so it was 9 years ago. So it's quite a lot of years ago. It was not so common to have the running contacts in that time. But I felt that I just need to teach her the running contacts on the dog walk, because maybe it's hard to believe now, but she was not so fast. She was 3 seconds from the fastest medium dogs in that time when she was 2 years. And because I was not so sure, it was my first dog to follow some program with the running contacts. Then I kept even the two on two off. So from the beginning, I taught her two on two off and the running. And later, I think when she was 7, I decided not to use the two on two off anymore, because I was not using it much. And I taught her better the turns on the dog walk with the running turns. And from the beginning, I used a target.
So I think you talked a little bit about this earlier, but I want to touch back base with you. Do you offer classes either online or live on running contacts, or what other topics do you teach? And I think if I have this correct, just from my little bit of online searching and creeping, you do a lot with jumping skills. Is there a place people can get more information if they want to do some learning from you?
Yes, so I offer online classes, and I have to say that I really enjoy it. So I like so much to train with the people, especially with the people who follows more my classes, because then I have the feeling like I would know them. Even, for example, they are from Australia, so I never met them live, but it's really great. And I don't offer running contacts class because I don't feel like I have enough experiences. I have some experiences, but I don't feel so strong, let's say. So maybe in the future, I have some students for running contacts, of course, but I don't offer online class for that. But I offer a lot of other classes. So I offer puppy class. In January, I will open new class, because I already said I have a border collie puppy, 9 months. So I will open a class where the people could follow what I train with her the first year. So everything I did with her, I videotaped, and it will be quite nice class, I guess. And in December, I will open the fifth class, as I said already. And then I offer jumping fun class, and it's about the grips exercises. Then I offer one and two jump exercises, and then handling class and special games. I already talked about the special games, that it's type of shaping. So thanks to my Border Collie Wifi, who had some jumping troubles, I found out new ways how to help him. And I was rewarded for that because it helped even Kiki to improve. So I really like those special games.
So is the easiest place for people to find out about your classes by reaching out to you on Facebook, or do you have your own personal website? Tell us how everybody can get a hold of those classes.
Yeah, so I feel very sorry that my websites are still not ready, but with the baby and moving to Italy, it's too many things, but they should be ready as soon as possible. I hope in February they will be ready so the people can read all the information there. Now I have a lot of information on my Facebook page. And of course, everybody can feel free to write me a message on my Facebook and to ask, and I will answer.
Okay, great. So we've talked about, you know, Kiki's history. We've talked about the AWC. Tell us a bit about your plans for the upcoming year. You already mentioned that you just recently moved to Italy. You have a border collie. I was pronouncing it Wi-Fi, but you pronounced it Wi-Fi that you are competing with. And then you have a puppy that you said is 9 months old. So what are your plans for them? Are you going to come back to the AWC in 2019 with either of the dogs?
I hope that Kiki will be in the great shape. So for sure we can start there because we are the world champions. So we have the free ticket. And I was always, last 2 years, I was very close with my border collie, Wifi, to qualify for the Czech Republic for World Championship. So we qualified for European Open, so we were there. It was really great. And so the plan is to do our best. He was a little bit unlucky because he had a health issue. Due to strong reaction for antiparasitic treatment. And because of that, later he had a lot of jumping troubles. But now he looks fine. And what is very, so maybe he will never be on the top of the top. But now again, we can run, we can have fun. So I'm thankful for that. And the rest we will see. We will do our best and we will see. And with my puppy, I'm following my puppy program. So we are working on the running contacts. We are working on the grids. We follow the fitness program. Of course, we are building better and better our relationship, but we have super relationship already because she's an angel. And when she will be 14 months, I will start to play with her on one and two jumps, and then we will see.
Well, thank you again for taking the time to let us interview you today. And for me, such an honor. Again, I feel like you have such a legacy in the sport with you and Kiki, and hopefully it's not over. Hopefully you'll have an awesome 2019 and we will see you back at the Agility World Championships next fall.
Oh, thank you. I hope so. She still look that she's 3 years old. So today it was snowing and she was just crazy and so happy and running like crazy. Not agility, now we have our break, but outside. So nobody would say that she's 10 years old. So I just hope that it will continue in that way. Thank you very much.
And that's it for this week's podcast. We'd like to thank our sponsors, HitItBoard.com, Elite Science, and also NTI Global. It's NTI Agility's biggest sale of the year. All items, all colors, all variations are made to order and on sale. These are the savings you've been waiting for. Visit shop.ntiglobal.com for the widest selection of dog agility tunnels for both competition and backyard training. Known for free shipping, more options, high quality products, and low prices, NTI Global has got you covered. They also offer tamer and anchor weight bags along with a full line of accessories and agility storage solutions. Need your agility gear in a hurry? Don't forget to check the in-stock selection. Visit shop.ntiglobal.com today. Happy training!
My wife left me because I'm too insecure. No, wait, she's back. She just went to get some coffee.